Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God. He whose word cannot be broken, formed thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded.
Since it's been a couple of weeks, I just thought I'd just very try to super briefly kind of go over what we've looked at so far at this point. As we were talking about 21, phrased it as like, here comes the bride, because it's a revelation of the new Jerusalem. And do you remember what the word new here actually means? We talked about it some. A new kind of something. In Greek, there's two words for new. One is new, like I got a new car, but the other is new in terms of a new kind of something. And this is a new Jerusalem that's coming. It mentions that it is coming down from heaven. It is a new kind of building, not like they would be used to seeing. And we're going to get more into that description and so forth when we take a look at all that. But in this place, there is a voice from the throne of God that is announcing that it's going to be a place where there's going to be no more tears, death, mourning, crying, or pain, because the old heavens and earth actually basically have been just like taken away. Were you raising your hand?
Yes. If, as you stop and think of it, all of this seems very logical that it's going to be a new kind. Why? And he tells us here, the sea's no more.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to have a new body.
Right.
It's going to be far different than the old body, because the corruptible is going to put on incorruption. The mortal is going to put on immortality. So God, just as in the beginning, if you look at the creation is very logical. I mean, he got everything ready before he said, let us make man in our image.
Right, yeah.
It's not surprising that man was the last of his creation.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Same thing here. The new heaven and the new earth, I don't know what it's going to be like, but it's going to be wonderful, and I want to be there.
Amen to that. And notice this last question that's on the slide up here. How much is going to be new? All things. It says all things are going to be made new. And God is calling attention to his faithfulness and the trueness of these words, and saying essentially that it is done. What do you mean by that?
His plan is complete.
His plan is complete. He's brought things full circle. Things have God has been planning things since the very beginning of time. That's important to know. I guess you could, in many respects, very much like I guess the book, there's been a paradise lost and a paradise now regained. And that's what God's plan has been this whole time, is trying to get people back to him. That's been the whole game plan from the very beginning. And now, that here at the very end, he is saying, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, and all things are done, completed. He says here also, I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of the water of life without cost, and the people that will be inheriting this will be who?
Saints.
The saints, the righteous.
Brother, excuse me.
Certainly.
Daniel chapter 7, verse like 18 and like 27, mm-hmm. He talks about the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom. Is this one of the blessings that he's talking about here? It's the church, right?
Yeah, that's exactly it. He's talking about the church. But when we're talking about the kingdom, we're also talking about something more than just what we would consider to be the church. The church began when? 33 AD, right?
Right.
And it'll go on. But the kingdom includes the church, most assuredly, but also includes all those who were faithful before Christ died. Now, we're told in Scripture that they still end up being saved by the blood of Christ. There's only one way to be saved. But it was because of their faith in God prior to all of that Christ's blood also now covers them as well. So the kingdom includes the church, most assuredly, but even more than that. Okay, so, I will be his God and he will be my son. And what's the significance of that part? He will be my son.
Inheritance.
Sons were the inheritors. And that's what he's making reference to. All those who are saints are going to be considered women and men here on the earth. They'll nevertheless be considered sons because they're all inheritors. All.
Which also reflects back to 1 John chapter 3, verse 1.
Yes.
Right, talk about the fact we're children of God.
Exactly. But that brings us down to verse 8, which is kind of where we left off, where he notes that there are some, on the other hand, who will not be here. Reading just a few verses from this point. It says, but for the cowardly and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and immoral persons and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the last plagues came and spoke to me, saying, come here and I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And we'll stop there for the moment. But from that point forward, we're going to take a look at the description, which is probably, once again, as we've talked about before, it's probably not a literal description, because the stuff that it's talking about doesn't really exist, at least in this world. Gold that is so pure, for example, that it is transparent like glass. So, in any case, however, we had started talking about who these people were. We had noted that it is not for the cowardly, and especially when we're talking about folks in the first century, certainly this applies to people of all ages, of all times, but who would the cowardly be, especially in this context?
It would be those that are afraid to acknowledge Jesus.
Yeah. They would be the faithless, and because they are faithless, therefore the fearful. One of the things that faith does for us, especially if we know what the hope of heaven is, if we're convinced of it, convicted of it, and are really confidently expecting it, does death really have just a whole lot of horror to it? Not nearly as much. And that's the whole point. Sometimes whenever people don't have that kind of assurance, then when persecution comes along, they're cowardly and they have the tendency to back right off and not do the right things. He also notes here the unbelieving. I think we had made mention of that as well. That this not only includes people who are what we would call atheists, I guess. It includes those people, certainly. But also, who else would be the unbelieving? What is biblical faith as opposed to the kind of faith that people oftentimes confess to having?
Biblical faith is the thing believed that comes from the Word of God, Romans 10:17.
That's true.
What you're looking for?
Well, that wasn't specifically what I was looking for, but that actually is a good answer. Yeah?
Excuse me. Would that be people who have other religions?
Well, it would include certainly people of other religions. That's true. If you happen to be Hindu, that would be unbelieving, because you're not believing specifically on Jesus Christ.
I guess it would be all non-believers of Jesus Christ.
Right, right. But I think it's also worthwhile noting, in addition to all of these things, that there may be some who might call themselves Christians. James chapter 2, starting in verse 14, tells us what about faith? That it has to be accompanied by good works, good deeds. And the rationale behind that is really quite simple. This is something that we deal with on every level. I think I've talked about this before, that I can confidently tell you I have never jumped off a 10-story building. Never. Not once. You know why? Here's my faith system. If I jump off that 10-story building, I'm going to go splat at the bottom. That's my faith system. I've never actually experienced it, but that's my faith, okay? As a consequence, my faith kind of informs my actions and behavior, you see. I think I've also used this illustration before as well whenever I was working at a mental asylum in New Hampshire. You sometimes end up seeing people walking down the hall and suddenly they'll do one of these things. And if you ask them why, they say, well, I saw a flock of birds flying at my face. Well, if you saw a flock of birds flying at your face, what would you do? I would duck and cover. That's what I would do. In that sense, was the man really that crazy? Well, I mean, he was seeing things, but you see what faith, because he believed what he saw. His faith caused him to act. And in a similar sort of way, you see, whenever it is that we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, how is that going, if we really believe it, not just say it, not just have it as an opinion, but if we really believe it, how is that going to affect us? We have to do something with it.
That's right.
We have to do something with it. I was going to save this for the invitation, but I may as well go ahead and do it a little bit now. In the Gospel of Luke, in chapter 9, we see the story of the Transfiguration. And Peter, you might recall, when he sees it, he sees the transfigured Jesus. He sees Moses and Elijah. And you know Peter, he just kind of blurts out whatever happens to be running through his head. He says, oh, Lord, it's good for us to be here. We'll build 3 tabernacles. Don't ask me what that means exactly, but, you know, that's what he said. But as he did so, there's a great cloud that comes over the mountain where they are, and a voice from heaven that says, anybody remember? This is my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased. What's the last few words? Listen to him. So if we believe that he really is the Son of God, what is it that we're going to do? Listen to him. Why? Well, because he's the Son of God.
That's John 14, 15, and 15, 14.
Or John 12, 48. If we're going to be judged by what he has to say, tell you what, how am I going to now live? What is it? It's 2 Peter chapter 3, isn't it? In which the Apostle Peter talks about how it is this world is going to be destroyed and about the end of time and all that sort of stuff. And he says, seeing as these things are so, how then should we live?
What type of person ought you to be?
Yeah. You see what faith does? If we really believe something, it is in fact going to affect how we behave. It really will. If I believe, I could start a rumor here, couldn't I? That a local bank was going to go was going to go out of business, and you had your money in that bank. What would you be doing tomorrow morning? Lining up to get the cash out, man.
That's, we also have faith that when an aircraft gets to the right speed, it's because it leaves the ground, right?
Yeah. Yeah. If you were boarding the airplane and you pass by the pilot's area up there and you got kind of a whiff of alcohol and you saw the pilot kind of slurring.
That's when you turn around and walk the other way.
Exactly. Because suddenly I believe, oh, yep, okay. I don't want to be on that plane. You see what faith does for us? So all that said, when it's talking then about being unbelieving, it certainly is talking about the atheist. It most assuredly is talking about people that are from other religions like Islam because they worship Allah, or Hindus because they worship a whole pantheon, or name the religion. If they do not believe in Jesus, they fit in that unbeliever category, but it even involves people who are Christian in name only too, doesn't it? Because you see, what they're doing is they're saying they believe, but it's not really affecting how they live, what they do. Yeah, and shudder, yeah. So, all that said, that's who the unbelieving are. And keep in mind here, again, who is this letter being written to initially, originally? First century Christians. And would they have had issues like this? issues like this have been around forever. And one of the things that we end up reading when we're reading the letters to the churches at the very beginning, there were nominal Christians then too, that John, well, actually Jesus, is trying to say, hey, come on, guys, you need to repent, you need to change your lives, because this is how you're living currently, this is how you need to be living, let's do it right. Of course, I'm paraphrasing, obviously, but Jim?
We need to stress verse 8, because the world today is trying to brush over.
Mm-hmm.
Paul says, these people will not be in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
When you get, mine says, people who are cowards, unbelievers, and perverts, that word pervert should be or could be translated homosexual.
It actually is the word fornicator.
John tells us here, and Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, that homosexuals will not be in heaven.
Well, that's right.
And he goes on to say, and such were
past
some
tense
of you.
Right.
That's right.
There may be some former, but there won't be any practicing homosexuals in heaven.
Yep.
But today we've got denominations that are welcoming these perverts in.
Or
they're even
making leaders out of them.
Preachers and priests,
yes,
and so forth that openly admit.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they've created a term to try to make us feel bad, homophobic.
Mm-hmm.
Try to put the guilt on us, but can't be any more plainer than what John or Paul said God's attitude towards the homosexual was.
Mm-hmm. And now, is God just trying to be mean here? I think it's important to understand God's not trying to be mean. He's telling it like it is. This who's getting into heaven, and this is who is not getting into heaven.
You don't approach it
at all
and tell the truth, you don't love, because
well, that's right.
It is a lie to teach that God's going to overlook that.
You're exactly right. You're exactly right. So, we mentioned the cowardly, the unbelieving. We've also read here the abominable. And it's actually, I kind of like the word. The Greek word basically means to stink. What do you suppose he's talking about there? Those who stink. You ever smelled something like I don't know, a skunk or something? Or I'm not trying to get too graphic, but you know, smelling vomit or something. It's like revolting. And are there not deeds that are revolting? Yeah. He also mentions murderers. What are murderers? And what's the difference between murder and killing? Or is there a difference?
There's a great difference.
There is. What's the difference, Ralph?
You know, we have a lot of people that go to war and they kill other people. And that's not murder. That is, matter of fact, the commandment, we say it as, thou shalt do no...
thou shalt not kill. Yeah.
But that really translates out, thou shalt do no murder.
Right.
Murdering is, how can I explain it? Well, not all murder is premeditated.
But it's basically to kill the innocent.
Yeah.
That's basically what it is. Because is execution given to us as a possibility that sometimes you can do? Well, yeah. Some people were executed. But that's not killing someone who's innocent. That's killing someone who is guilty. Combat is a different sort of thing. But murder, very specifically, is killing someone who is innocent. Yes.
I think one of the things we need to remember when we go through these descriptive terms, mm-hmm, is that it's the act that we hate, not the people.
That's right.
You know, these people need the gospel just as much as all the rest of us, and Christ died for these individuals as well.
Right.
The fact that they're living in sin is what you and I and everybody else in this room need to be able to take the gospel to that group of people.
Well, that's right. And kind of to Jim's point, going back to 1 Corinthians chapter 6,
that's right.
He does say, and such were some of you. You know what? When we're reading through some of these things, could have our name all over some of these things, right?
We're starting to see some real stuff go on in these days. Mm-hmm. I say these days in the last maybe couple of years. I recently saw in the news just a few days ago that the Pope says that they're going to start blessing homosexual marriage, homosexual unions. The Pope.
Mm-hmm.
That's evidently the leader of a lot of people.
Right.
But when your belief is not in the truth or has no basis in truth, then you can do anything you want to.
Well, you can, and I think it also has a great deal to do with how people have oftentimes forgotten the last part of that transfiguration announcement. Listen to him. Listen to him.
Mark, this stuff's old, though. It's not relevant to today. A lot of it's just kind of old-timey stuff.
Yeah, just old-fashioned stuff.
Speaking?
Yeah. I think he has about a mile and a half of tongue-in-cheek there. His tongue is, his cheek is way out here. But yeah, immoral persons, that's actually the word porneo, and it makes reference to, the way the King James translates it is fornicators. And fornication actually ends up being a wide, wide term that includes everything from premarital sex to homosexuality to just anything that would be sexually perverted. Yes, sir?
English Standard Version uses sexually immoral.
Sexually immoral, yeah. So it covers a wide range, everything including adultery and any other kind of sexual sin that you can imagine. It also mentions here sorcerers. What's a sorcerer?
Witchcraft.
Witchcraft.
It's witchcraft. It's anyone pretty much who dabbles in the occult. Why is that bad?
They say they can talk to the dead.
That's right. There's a specific kind of sorcerer who is called a necromancer, and he says that he can speak with the dead. They're also called mediums sometimes. But basically the reason that speaking to the dead and the occult and witchcraft and all that, basically it's calling upon evil spirits to help out. That's what sorcery basically was almost all about. Now,
you're going to the wrong doctor.
Going to the wrong doctor, yeah. Yeah, that's exactly right. Now,
I think I recall something with Saul.
Yeah.
Was it Saul who was going to battle and he got all upset because he didn't know what was going to happen? God had been helping him quite a bit. And
God was now silent.
So he called on, I can't think of her name right now.
The Witch of Endor is what she's referred to as. Yeah.
And she actually came, and at least she thought she summoned
Samuel.
Sam. Whether she did or not, she was quite surprised about it, it seemed.
Yeah, apparently this is the single exception that God made to the command, don't do this. And he probably did it so that Saul could get the message, you're in big trouble. You're in deep, deep trouble, buddy. But yeah, this is the one incident in which trying to raise the dead and talking with them actually worked. But the reason basically for the abolition or the commands against it have everything in the world to do with who you're making the appeal to help out. You're appealing to the evil spirits. That's what's going on. When you take a look at Deuteronomy chapter 18, where it forbids all this stuff, you know, sometimes you can tell a lot by taking a look at the negative of something and then the positive of something. In this particular instance, he says, don't listen to these people. Don't seek them out. Don't do away with them. Forbid it to be in Israel at all. Why? Because I want you to listen to me. That's what he says. You got a question? Come to me. If there's an answer, I'll give it to you. Jim?
One of Satan's tools, and we've all run across it if we've studied with very many people trying to lead them to Christ, is people see a list like this and you know, they mentally make more than one check mark, and they begin to say, well, God could never forgive me for all of that. Mm-hmm. My favorite passage of Scripture probably in the whole New Testament is when Peter asked Jesus, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother who sins against me and then repents? Up to seven times? And Jesus said, no, Peter, not seven times, but 70 times seven. He did that for us. He wasn't telling Peter that you need to forgive him. He's telling us that God will forgive us that many times if we truly do repent and change our way of life.
Yeah. The Apostle Paul says something very similar. He calls himself the chief of sinners. And he says, but God saved me, and I'm paraphrasing here, obviously. But Paul says, you know, one of the reasons that God saved me is so that he could use me as an example. If God could forgive me, he can forgive anybody. Because I was not just your average, everyday, run-of-the-mill sinner. I was trying to persecute the church into oblivion. That's what I was trying to do. So he goes on and talks about idolaters. What's an idolater?
Somebody
practices idolatry. Very good.
Anything above God.
Mr. Webster. one who does bow down to an idol, but it doesn't necessarily have to be just that. It also includes, the book of Colossians talks about materialism as being a form of idolatry. Essentially, idolatry is any time that we ever end up looking to something as being security except God. And that's why it is that money becomes idolatry, because part of the reason sometimes that people end up accumulating money is for that rainy day. I want to get, you know, just in case something terrible happens, and they save it up and save it up and save it up, you see. And, well, in addition to that, they also worship what it is that they have gotten or what they can end up obtaining with it. But you can do the same thing with a lot of stuff. I might go so far as to say, this is not too terribly politically incorrect, but sometimes nations can build up tremendous armaments and find their security in the weapons that they've got. What was the security that Israel had all those years? It was really God. You might recall that God had even commanded them, I don't want you to have chariots. In fact, when you conquer some of these people who use chariots, I want you to hamstring the horses so you can't use them for that. Well, why, God? That's the cutting edge of weaponry. Why? God wanted them to depend upon him and not the weapons, you see. Well, so all liars. And why, by the way, is he making mention of this? This is, by the way, isn't that the scripture where when someone's telling a fib, we all end up quoting Revelation chapter 21:8?
Satan is the father of lies, so anytime we lie, we're
his child.
Acting like...
Speaking his language. That's what we're doing. Yeah.
Speaking his language.
But specifically, since it is that we just got through talking about how it is that... Remember what Satan was going to be doing, what he couldn't do anymore when he's being bound? Couldn't deceive the nations any longer. And but what he's going to do whenever it is that he is loosed? Now he's going to go back and deceive the nations. In fact, we end up seeing this idea of deception quite frequently, not only in Revelation, but also in like 2 Thessalonians as well, chapter 2. But the idea basically being that anyone who is deceiving... I think he has very specifically those who are telling lies religiously about spiritual reality. Those are the liars in particular. He probably has in mind very specifically, though. Certainly just telling a lie itself is not a good thing in the story. Any other thoughts about any of that? What are they going to be inheriting?
The lake of fire.
The lake of fire. Eek. The lake of fire. But then, starting in verse 9, We have an opportunity to see the surpassing, breathtaking beauty of the bride. Let's start reading in verse 10. It says, "And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her brilliance was like a very costly stone, as a stone of crystal clear jasper. It had a high and a great and high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names were written on them, which were the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel. There were three gates on the east, three gates on the three gates on the north, three gates in the south, and three gates on the west. And the wall of the city had 12 foundation stones, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The one who spoke with me had a gold measuring rod to measure the city and its wall, and its gates and its wall. The city is laid out as a square, and its length was as great as the width. And he measured the city with the rod 1,500 miles. Its length and width and height are equal. And he measured its wall 72 yards according to human measurements, which are also angelic measurements. The material of the wall was jasper, and the city was pure gold, like clear glass. The foundation stones of the city wall were adorned with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation stone was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each one of the gates was a single pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold like transparent glass. I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God the Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need of the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God has illumined it, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it in the daytime, for there will be no night there. Its gates will never be closed. They will bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. And nothing unclean, and no one who practices abomination and lying shall ever come into it, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." So, we find John being taken up to a high place. Can you think of a couple of other folks that were taken up to a high place to be shown something?
Jesus
was, that's right. Yeah, exactly. Moses and Jesus both. So, what is the holy city, Jerusalem, as we're talking about it here? What is it? It's heaven, simply put. What's the first thing that John notes about this holy city? Well, it has the glory of God. You can follow this, right? It has the glory of God in it. So, what's glory anyway? I'm seeing a whole lot of shrugging going on.
Magnificence.
It's a word we use, but magnificence, that's a good way of putting it. Or brightness sometimes, or splendor, honor even. But brilliance, usually, especially in this particular context, is probably making mention of the brilliance of the place. And its brilliance was like, it says, a very costly stone. What are we talking about? Explain what this is. Expand on this. I mean, it's reasonably obvious what it's saying, but what are we talking about here? True. And generally speaking, what makes a costly stone costly?
Purity
sometimes?
Well, actually, the value that we place on it.
Yeah.
And that's what happens. That's what the problem is with grace going through the eyes of the camel going through the eyes of the
camel. Yeah. What makes us think that a stone is valuable? it usually has a whole lot to do with sparkly, doesn't it? About how sparkly it is. Yes.
I kind of forgot what I was going to say now.
Sorry. I blew it for you.
I'll get back to you.
Gotcha. Charles?
Well, I think the part of the costly is due to the rarity or the hard to come by.
Yeah, yeah. And so that's really, it's important to do more than just simply take a look at these words and say, oh, okay. It's important to say or ask the question, why is it being described this way? And what are we to get out of it? Ralph, did it come to you?
What I was going to say was, we have a man trying to describe something that is so magnificent.
Yeah.
He's using the only words that he can come up with here.
Yeah.
He's comparing it to things that we know here on earth.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's like we've talked about before. It's like trying to explain the color red to a child born blind from birth. We just don't have the vocabulary for it. So John is doing the very best he can to try to describe something to us with words that we can understand. And the metaphors may or may not be directly applicable, but at least the idea, at least poetically, we can certainly understand what we're talking about here. The city looks like a costly stone standing out by itself in its brilliance, in its splendor, in its glory, like a costly, sparkly stone. Crystal clear like jasper. If you've got a handout, I gave you a little picture of what jasper looks like. Is jasper clear? No. But it's kind of reddish, and so, you know, possibly maybe that's something of what they're trying to get across to, what John's trying to get across.
You know, regardless of stone, what happens when light hits it?
Yeah.
Kind of what you were saying about sparkly or whatever, but when the light reflects from whichever costly stone we're talking about, it sparkles and shines and glistens. And, you know, look, and you mentioned glory. What is the glory of God? Well, later on it says, you know, there's no need for sun or moon because the glory of God illuminates it.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If that vast glory emanating from God is hitting all these costly stones.
Yeah, it's just got to be blinding, as it were.
Yeah.
Well, he goes on and talks about how it has a high wall. It mentions there a great and high wall with 12 gates. And in the 21st century, living in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, we're kind of going, okay, cool. It looks like an old medieval town. But what's the idea behind it, behind this great and high wall?
It's going to be nice to be there.
Be nice to be there?
Safety.
That's what walls were about. It's really important to pardon me, to listen and read this from the perspective of the folks that were reading it the first time. Great and high walls meant safety. You put walls up because you wanted to keep the bad guys out. That was the whole point. I set myself an alarm so that I wouldn't go so far over time as I usually do. So let me just kind of finish this particular slide up. That's what the idea, this great and high wall is talking about safety. It's a safe place. The ancient world wasn't a very safe place. Certainly they had some soldiers and so forth, but did they have a police department? No. Did they have a highway department or a highway patrol or anything along? No. And so every once in a while they would have the bad guys coming at the gate, basically wanting to plunder and pillage. That's what they did. That's how you got rich. That was basically one of the main reasons for warfare in the ancient world. It wasn't because you guys believe one thing and you guys believe a different thing. We go to war more often than not, well, a lot of times, because of political differences. The ancients went to war a lot of times because of money. That's the way you got rich. All that said, it was about safety. The world wasn't very safe that they were living in, but heaven safe.
Well, there were 12 gates, and there was an angel at each gate protecting the gate also. And, you know, we tend to think in terms of angels. We see pictures of a beautiful womanly type figure with wings on and stuff. And I tend to think that some of these angels are quite large and quite fierce. That's a good word.
Yeah. It's true, especially if they happen to be some of the cherubim. There are pictures of cherubim, and they're pretty fierce looking. They're pretty fierce looking. So they're.
We think Raiders of the Lost Ark. Remember how the face started out beautiful, and then all of a sudden turned into something fierce.
Yeah, not a, you know, movies aren't really good for theology, but every once in a while they strike the right chord, and I think that's one of them. There's 12 gates, and each of them are named. What are they named? After the tribes of Israel. Now, if you think about, as we're going to go through, the city is going to be measured as being how wide by how long by how high? 1,500 miles. And is there anything interesting about it being as high as it is wide and long? To cube. Where else have we seen cubes?
Why would it be limited to 1,500 miles?
Because it would take too long to measure any more than that. But where else do we see cubes?
The Holy of Holies.
The Holy of Holies. Now later on we end up finding, as we read just a few minutes ago, that there's no need for a temple here. Why? Because God and the Lamb are the temple. So this New Jerusalem is like the Holy of Holies in which we have an opportunity to live. And by the way, speaking of the tabernacle and the temple, and all of that, there's three gates on the west, east, south, and north, right? You remember in reading in the Old Testament when the tabernacle was set up? Tabernacle was in the middle, and three of the tribes were on the north, three of the tribes were on the south, three on the east, three on the west. We almost have like a perfect situation with regard to even the wilderness wanderings. At least there's a reference there to it. It's guarded by 12 angels. It's named after 12 tribes. There are three gates that are facing each cardinal direction. And there are 12 foundation stones with names of the apostles. And these 12 foundation stones, by the way, I think I've got it on the thing there. It's this picture right here. This is actually the western wall of the temple that's still there. You can still see it. The guys that are there are Jewish guys that are praying. They're doing one of these things as they're praying. But I wasn't looking at necessarily the guys that are there. I want you to look at the stones that are there. These stones are like somewhere in the ballpark of 10 feet long, about 3 feet high, maybe 3 or 4 feet deep. They have a special name called ashlars. And the scripture is going to go off and talk about how it is that each one of these are a gemstone. Now, most gemstones are maybe an inch wide, inch tall, you know, whatever. This is like a couple of hundred thousand times more than any gemstone that any of them would know. We're going to read also about how every gate is what? A single pearl. And the walls are made out of jasper, so clear that they're like transparent glass. And the city itself is made out of gold that's transparent like glass. Whew. What would that end up saying to a first century reader?
I bought a piece of jasper about the size of two postage stamps there a while back. Paid $10 for it, so it's not cheap.
No, it's not cheap. And it's important to keep in mind, in the ancient world, looking at or thinking about the proportions, how many folks proportionately were rich in the ancient world? Very, very few. 2-3%. How many were middle class?
None.
It almost didn't exist. So that leaves how many people being poor? The vast majority, over 90%. And we're not just talking about poor, we're generally talking about hand-to-mouth poor, grinding poverty poor. That's what most people were. You're describing this to people like that? What is it saying? No more want. No more lack of anything. Shoot. You can go ahead and use pavement for legal tender, right? Made out of gold. So, you know, I'm just trying to point these things out because, you know, when we read this, we are, even in the 21st century, we go, whoa, that's kind of really cool. But to those people especially, what was it saying? Wow, this is amazing. This is amazing. Well, I'm going to shift over to devotional. As I mentioned before, in the Transfiguration, we can read about Luke chapter 9. We find Jesus on the mountaintop. He's there with three of his closest disciples, Peter, James, and John. And as he is there, he's transfigured. And when Peter, James, and John, because the scripture says they actually had been asleep, I guess they'd walked up a pretty tall mountain. They were asleep, and when they wake up, they find Jesus transfigured, looking a whole lot more like his real self as opposed to his human look. And he was talking with Moses and Elijah. And Peter, being the kind of guy that generally kind of speaks whatever is running through his head at the moment, pipes up and says, it's good for us to be here. We can build three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. That probably, you know, Jesus never did this, but I imagine at least he probably went like that. But God really did the answering. The cloud overspreads the top of the mountain, and God says, this is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. Don't listen to your opinions. Don't listen to the first thing that runs through your head. Don't listen to all the other stuff, all the other voices and so forth that might be out there. Listen to him. Listen to Jesus. The world is full of opinions. The world is full of I think so's. But in the end, we're not going to be judged by my think so. We're not going to be judged by what some theologian says. You're not going to be judged by what Park has to say. You're going to be judged by what it is that the Lord has to say. That's why God said, listen to him. And what we've been told in Scripture is that we need to believe that Jesus really is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And that belief needs to motivate us to repent from our sins. And that faith needs to also motivate us to being willing to confess with our mouth who we believe he really is. Say it out loud in front of people. That faith needs to motivate us, in fact, to be obedient believers, obedient to the point of being immersed in water in the name of Jesus Christ for forgiveness of our sins, at which point we have all of our sins forgiven, wiped away, and we're on our way to heaven. From that point, we just need to live faithfully. We need to live with our feet on the path of light. This evening, if in thinking about some of these things, you've come to the conclusion that maybe your life is really not been what it needs to be. You know, we were looking a little bit earlier at a section in which there were all these lists of various sins that people committed that would not be allowed to get into heaven. And the comment was made that isn't it a great thing, isn't it a marvelous thing that God's grace can cover all of that. It is true. No matter what it is that you might have done, the Lord is willing and will forgive. If only we'll come to him. And this evening, if you need to do that as a Christian, we encourage you to do that. You can do that where you're sitting, right where you are. And if it happens to be this evening that you've never become a Christian according to the New Testament pattern, or the things I just mentioned before, including especially baptism into Christ, we want to encourage you. Please do that. And do it tonight. Because indeed, we really don't know what tomorrow brings. And wouldn't it be a wonderful thing to go home this very evening knowing your sins are all forgiven? This evening, if you have need to respond to God's generous call, we encourage you to come forward while we stand and sing.
Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion.